Thanks for joining me today. The two bills that I just signed allow us to fully fund state government for the month of April. And I'm asking the legislature to come back in to fully fund May and June. Let me make something very clear to the people of Oklahoma. We had a deal with the legislature to fully fund state government for April, May, and June of this year, which is fiscal year 2020. I'm committed to standing by that deal. House leadership wanted to use this time to play Washington, D.C. politics and sneak in some last-minute changes while Oklahomans are hurting. We are in unprecedented times, and my administration has been working around the clock on hospital surge plans, standing up more ICU beds, finding more ventilators and PPE from around the world. We've issued multiple executive orders to protect our first responders and all of our healthcare workers around the state. The bills the legislature sent me fully funded everything except for one priority, digital transformation. That broke our agreement. Digital transformation is more important now than ever before. Let me give you some perspective. Right now, we have 33,000 state employees working from home, digitally accessing their computers in the state office. We have 165,000 Oklahomans who have applied for unemployment. That means they have lost their jobs. They're waiting in long lines, on hold in a call center. We have an outdated website, and we are making major improvements to turn that turn time around. Our health department is adding Google chatbots and other technology to make sure Oklahomans can access the information they need. We've had a great working relationship with the legislature, so I was really surprised that this happened. It's just frustrating for me, and I'm sure it is for all of Oklahomans, that some think this is the time to play political games. We had a deal, and I am committed to that deal to fully fund state government for April, May, and June. I want to put this to bed, but the people of Oklahoma elected me to hold true to my word. I'd be letting them down if I allowed the House leadership to try to play gotcha politics during this time. Let's get this handled the right way, and we can get back to working on the future to make Oklahoma a top 10 state. I know a lot of Oklahomans are hurting right now. Like I said before, 165,000 Oklahomans have lost their jobs and have been applying for unemployment. We've had tens of thousands of small businesses that are really hurting right now. But I want them to know as well, we're going to get through this. Our state has taken unprecedented actions to help these Oklahoma families. This is why there's no time to play politics. I'm asking the legislature to come back in and fully fund state government for May and June of this year. I also have Secretary of Commerce and Workforce Development, Sean Kouplen, here with us to share a little bit about what we're doing, some of the projects we're doing to help the small businesses and also the families that are hurting. Mr. Kouplen.
Thank you so much, Governor. We know that businesses and employees across our state are really struggling right now. And so I was hoping to share some information today with them that would help them during this very difficult time. First of all, we want to encourage anyone that is looking for work across the state of Oklahoma to download our free app called OK Job Match. It's very, very easy to use. We have tens of thousands of jobs that are still available within the state, and that is a great resource for them to use. We also want to let every business in Oklahoma know that every Wednesday, starting at 8 a.m. on the hour until 5 p.m. at night, we host 8 different industry calls. I lead those calls, and we provide different industries with the latest information from state government, as well as federal programs that might be able to help them as well. I'm excited today to announce the Oklahoma Manufacturing Reboot Program. This is a brand new program from the Department of Commerce in which we are repurposing closing funds that we typically use to attract businesses into the state, but we instead want to use those dollars to help existing businesses. These will be grants from $25,000 to $150,000 for manufacturers all over the state to help retool and prepare for this very challenging time that we are in. Medical service providers will be prioritized, but any manufacturer can enjoy this new program. I also want to announce that the $600 in additional weekly funds that are coming in through the new stimulus program for our unemployed Oklahomans are here. Those have started coming in about 2 days ago. We've dispersed a little over $44,000 in these weekly funds already, and we are processing more as we speak. Finally, I just want to share that there are two federal programs that we believe are our business's best opportunity to raise additional capital during this difficult time. The first program is called the SBA Disaster Loan Program. This is a loan, this is a program that our businesses can apply directly with the SBA at disasterloan.sba.gov. It is a low interest line of credit. It has a 30-year term, 3.75% interest for for-profit businesses, 2.75% for nonprofit businesses, and it is an excellent way for them to obtain long-term, flexible, fixed-rate capital to help their business make it through these times. The second program, which is very popular right now, is called the Paycheck Protection Program through the CARES Act. This is part of the new stimulus program. This program is available until June 30th, 2020. It is well funded. It was initially funded at $349 billion, and it appears that additional funding is coming into the program soon. Loans will have 100% SBA guarantee. They're unsecured, no personal guarantee, and no fees whatsoever to the business. The program is administered through your local bank, and virtually every bank in Oklahoma is providing this program. The loan amount is the lesser of 2.5 times monthly payroll, average monthly payroll for the business, or $10 million if it's a very large company. Payroll consists of all types of compensation to U.S. residents. It can include wages, commissions, tips, vacation, insurance premiums, and retirement. Independent contractors and sole proprietors cannot be included in a company's payroll because these individuals can apply on their own for the Paycheck Protection Program. Any payroll over $100,000 does not count for purposes of this program, but everything else does. As long as loan proceeds are used to cover payroll, rent, mortgage interest payments, and utilities during the 8-week program, all of the loan will be forgiven and the small business will not have to pay it back. Your payroll numbers must be equal to or greater than your employee count prior to the COVID-19 crisis hit us, and the salary that you pay to your employees must be at least 75% of what you paid prior to the COVID-19 crisis. And as long as those items are met, all of the loan will be forgiven. Small businesses up to 500 employees, or those that meet SBA size standards, do qualify for this new program. In closing, I just want to say how remarkable the innovation of Oklahoma businesses has been. We have some amazing examples. Covercraft Industries in Paul's Valley went from making car seat covers to gowns and masks to help our healthcare workers. Rapid Application Group in Broken Arrow went from making aerospace parts to making protective face shields and masks. Century Martial Arts went from making world-class martial arts gear to making face masks for us. And Aon, a well-known company in Tulsa, shipped 44 units to New York for temporary hospitals up there within 9 days from the time the order was placed. They charge no expediting orders, and that is truly the Oklahoma standard. So we understand what our employees and our companies are facing. We stand ready. Details of all of these programs are available at the Department of Commerce website, okcommerce.gov, and we are definitely here to help. Thank you, Governor.
Thank you, Secretary Kouplen. You know, we can get you all that information. There's a lot of that money's been encumbered. A lot of the money is for technology across 160 different state agencies. With this new crisis that has popped up, we of course want to pour resources in the unemployment commission. We've had unprecedented claims right now, and so I've directed a lot of resources to fix that problem. Stand up new call centers. We've put more bodies at it because Oklahomans need to get those unemployment benefits as quick as possible.
Governor, how much do you believe the House shortchanged
digital transformation? Well, with what I just signed today, it was $930,000. But really the question is, why would we fund $450 million and 100% of state government for April, May, and June, but exclude one small piece? That's the question.
Is that small piece, though, $247,000?
I'm sorry?
Is that small piece $247,000?
It's not a small piece, but it's actually $930,000.
But how much was the cut to digital transformation?
Well, I don't know the names of it, but the two bills that I just signed today fully funded state government except for $930,000 in the digital transformation. $930,000 was the cut. But really, Oklahomans elected me to come here to keep my word, to tell them the truth is what's happening, and I'm being transparent with Oklahomans. We had a deal to fully fund state government. That deal was broken. That's why I'm up here. That's why I'm letting Oklahomans know what's happening. I want the legislature to come back in so we can fully fund state government for April, May, and June.
Those bills passed by veto-proof margins, are you at all concerned we'll come back and do a veto override?
I'm not concerned about that at all. Number one, the one bill doesn't go into effect if I don't have the Board of Equalization meeting. So there was never a way to get the money in without the Board of Equalization meeting. It's null and void. I don't sign it or veto it.
Governor, what does you singled out of the House, and that's where the bill originated. President Tree said when we asked him why that was singled out, he said he asked the House. House has said no comment to us publicly. What have they said to you?
You would have to ask the House about it. I think the Senate had no idea about this. This is politics with the House leadership.
What was the discussion? What did they tell you was the reason for that meeting?
You can ask them why that happened, but I went up right up to the Speaker's office and I said, hey, what's the deal? So that's why we're here today.
Do you worry that it's not worthwhile to stop any of this other funding and have the legislature all come back for less than $1 million cut when we have a $450 million shortfall?
I am fully funding state government for April. There's plenty of time for the legislature to come back and fix this for May and June. That's what I'm asking them to do. We had an agreement. I'm going to stick with the agreement. Your word on these agreements is you have to stick by your word. And so when we have an agreement, we've got to stick with it. I want to fully fund 2020, April, May, and June. The legislature, we have plenty of time to get this fixed. I will fully fund with the bills I sign. I will fully fund April.
You were big on saving that $200 million last year. How do you feel when they come back and cut something and you obviously put the state in that position to be in the position to fail?
You know, that's a really important question. Point, and I want Oklahomans to know, had we not been fiscally responsible and saved $200 million last year, we would only have $800 million in our savings account. And we would be looking at a $650 million hole for April, May, and June. So it was really fortuitous. It was, it's really showing good leadership, fiscal responsibility. We had a lot of criticism when we did that, but it's really proven to be the right move last session. Well, that's definitely a possibility, but we're really talking about fully funding state government April, May, and June, and that was the deal, and that's what we're trying to stick to. We're going to be able to get through the crisis, but what's so disappointing is when we're working 24 hours a day to address the COVID crisis, and then to come in here and play politics is very disappointing, and that's what I wanted Oklahomans to understand is happening. Well, I think they were posted Friday about 8 o'clock, and we learned about them over the weekend.
Governor, real quick, I was looking up digital transformation earlier today, and I went on the innovate.ok.gov website, and I saw some things on there that I want to ask you about. I noticed actually just before your press conference that the website went down, and I don't know whether that's intentional or not, but several of the pages had what is referred to as Latin placeholder text. Noted there were 8 projects complete that were live, there were 16 in beta, 1 in alpha, but under the description of digital transformation, it was just Latin placeholder text. Can you talk to what the A, do you have any comment about that? Is the website being redone? And then B, what sort of things has that money been used for so far that you believe are possible?
We give a report every single month. We've given over 6 reports to the legislatures, to the leadership. We send it out on a monthly basis. So we'll be happy to give you that, giving them a kind of an update of what's happened with digital transformation. We could get our secretaries up that focus on that and give you the exact projects they're doing. I can't speak specifically to the specifics of what they're addressing, but we've had state government is on PeopleSoft, you know, like version 2.0, and we've got an effort to get it to the current version is like 35. That's how far behind we are in state government across state agencies. So we've got a lot of work to do. I think Oklahomans understand how important digital transformation is. But the real point I'm trying to make is when you think about, we were fully funding state government for April, May, and June. That was the deal. That's what we expected to stay with. I am fully funding it for April. I'm asking the legislature to come back in here and make May and June correct.
Governor, just 2 questions. First, just as a technical matter, you said you won't sign 199, leaving it null and void. Isn't that a veto for all intents and purposes? And what do you do if they override?
Well, you can't override it because until the Board of Equalization meets, the Constitution says the Board of Equalization has got to certify any kind of revenue failure to pull money out of the rainy day fund. So that bill cannot be activated until you have a Board of Equalization meeting.
Didn't all the reports, you mentioned it, Trace.
Carmen, go ahead.
I looked at those reports, and none of them show funding the things that you talked about here today. State employees working from home, the Employment Security Commission, the Digital Transformation Fund, as far as I can tell, I don't know if it's been funding anything yet, but the projects on its, you know, sort of radar, like mobile ID, and then a couple other things, but not the ones you mentioned today.
We'll get you the report of exactly what they've been working on.
Didn't
OMES
eventually declare a revenue failure on Friday?
OMES notified a revenue failure, but the Constitution is very clear that the Board of Equalization has to certify the revenue failure before you can tap into the Rainy Day Fund. When the OMES declares a revenue failure, that authorizes straight cuts across the board. I don't want to do that. I'm trying to fully fund April, May, and June. That was why we had an agreement on Friday. That's why I was so shocked when I came in here and realized that they sent me a bill that fully funded April, May, and June, except for one thing. And so you can ask them why they did it. No, we absolutely need to tighten our belt. That's something we can talk about for 2021, 2022. It looks like that the revenue, we'll have some reports later on from the Board of Equalization meeting if we get a chance to meet on what that looks like in 2021 and 2022. But right now I'm focused on fixing 2020 and then getting back to work on the health and lives and focus on the COVID surge plans.
So no cuts for 2020?
Correct.
A lot of House members have said this is a power play on your part. Your response to that?
Truth's on my side. I'm telling Oklahomans exactly what happened. We had an agreement to fund April, May, and June. They sent me a bill that didn't fund April, May, and June except for one thing. One priority, digital transformation. That's breaking a deal.
How much money is in that fund right now? And is that enough to get through the rest of this fiscal year without having this particular issue?
I think that in the fund is about $8 million. I don't know how much of that is encumbered through contracts as we're preparing for new technology throughout different state agencies. It's not really the point. The point is we had an agreement to fully fund April, May, and June, and that agreement was broken.
Governor, clarify that. Who made that agreement with you? How was that agreement made and when was it made?
It was made on Friday between the leadership and myself, that's and the appropriations chairs. We agreed that it was going to play out exactly like it did, except for the digital transformation.
Do you have Charles why they could go back on that deal?
You'll have to ask them.
Did Charles McCall make that agreement with you face to face?
The leadership of the House, the leadership of the Senate, and the appropriations chairs, yes.
Just to be clear, do you have any plans for a BOE meeting anytime soon, or do you just wait to see what they do?
I'm waiting for the legislature to come back to fully fund May and June. We'll talk about that, and then, of course, we will have a Board of Equalization meeting once we have an agreement again.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.